Assalamu alaikum, good afternoon everybody. Welcome everybody to this workshop with the title of Living with the Wolf. I'll tell you a little bit the idea came up with the workshop because since I came back from Canada, my colleague said we had enough from arthritis, whether it's RA or seronegative, and it's time to talk about other diseases. And everybody felt that lupus was a forgotten disease. So we thought we should get this workshop talking about this fascinating disease for me with all this, what they call multi-phases and faces too. And I was talking to Dr. Parham and Dr. Fort, and I think it also has multinationality because definitely when I came back from Kuwait, I've seen very difficult cases with the CNS manifestation, nephritis manifestation. I think it was different from the cases we've seen in Canada, whether we're during our training in the teaching hospital or even in the community and covering the community hospital. So I was looking at Dr. Barman's CV yesterday, and I came across this interesting editorial she wrote in 2006, and I thought it would be nice to start with that editorial. This was written in 2007 in the Nature Clinical Practice Nephrology with the title, Why Are Rheumatologists Treating Lupus Nephritis? And I started to laugh when I saw the title because after reading the editorial, she was sort of angry why nephrologists are not taking the leads in the in treating nephritis. And in fact, she hit the point with my hidden agenda. I wanted to bring the disease back to rheumatologists. And I told her before the workshop started, this is definitely not the case in the Middle East because there's no question that nephrologists are the leaders and the key players on treating nephritis, and we wanted to actually gain our territory back. We want the rheumatologist to be back in charge. So I'll just quote her here, quote Dr. Bogner here in the editorial said, quote, how did this transfer of ownership of lupus nephritis to rheumatologists happen? There are two possible reasons. Either rheumatologists hijack lupus nephritis as part of overall management of systemic lupus erythematosus. For a second, I felt we're part of ISIS, but obviously, we have nice Canadian like Dr. Fortin, who are not hijackers. And we, or more likely, she actually put explanation that nephrologists lost interest in this disease because they become occupied with other stuff. And she ended up the actually part of the story said which were over the two scenarios responsible ownership of lupus nephritis by rheumatologists became a self-fulfilling prophecy. I thought that was interesting to read. So the reason we set up this basically we want to bring multi-specialty doctors, a dermatologist, a hematologist, a rheumatologist, and a nephrologist because you're all aware that this disease has multi-manifestation can affect any part of the body. So I'll just go over the agenda quickly. I'm sorry we started late, but it was a prayer time and we have to wait half an hour. So we're half an hour late, so we'll add half an hour on these agenda. So the first lecture will be by Dr. Paul Fortin, which titled The Imitation Game, Current Issues in the Management of Lupus, followed by a lecture by Dr. Huda, who is a dermatologist trained in Canada. Who specialize and has interest in treating lupus. Then we'll have the first lecture by Dr. Bagman with the title Lupus Nephritis from Recommendation to Practice. Then the second lecture of Dr. Fortin with the title Treatment of Lupus as an Emergency in Slow Motion. We will have a 45 minutes break for the lunch and then we're reunion again with two more lectures by Dr. Bagman and one more lecture from Dr. Mona Rashid, who is a hematologist. With an interest in connective tissue disease, we'll talk about diagnosis and management of refractory cytopenias. All these lectures will be video recorded. They will be provided in a CD with a physician who attended today and also will be a video links in YouTube. So we'll send you all the video links to all the lectures. So even if you wanted to show, you were interested, you want to go back, you can see it in the lecture. So I'll introduce the first speaker, Dr. Paul Fortin, who's actually was my mentor in Toronto before he moved to Quebec City. He's a rheumatologist who had a medical degree from the University of Laval in Quebec City, and then went to a rheumatology program in McGill University. Then he went to Boston, where he did first the master's in the public health from Harvard University. And then he did a 3 years program of clinical epidemiology also in Harvard University. He became an assistant associate professor at McGill University before he moved to Toronto, where he became a full professor in 2007. He decided for many reasons to go back to Quebec City in 2011. He's a well-known rheumatologist in Canada and Toronto and like the whole country with a publication of 300 plus. He has a main interest in measuring outcome with lupus. He's very focused on a patient perspective. He wants to test the validity and comes with tool to test the patient perception with the disease, how they feel, and also integrated with the physician tool to measure disease activities. In 1995, he was the creator of the Canadian Network for Improved Outcome in SLEs, we called CANUS. It actually initially had a specific objective, but with time, I think it became a big organization. It became one of the center organization for organizing trials in general, and he probably will talk about some of these experience in the network. Dr. Fortner also received multiple awards, including the Kirkland Scholar Award in 2007. In fact, he was just awarded also in May, actually, this month. He received a very prestigious award from the Jeffrey Shrickley Research Award. So welcome, Dr. Fortner.
So thank you very much for inviting me, Yasser. This is my first trip to Kuwait. I'm quite impressed and just arrived, and it's 48 degrees, I'm told, outside. It's going to be maximum 18 degrees in Quebec City today, 12 tomorrow, so can you imagine? I'm going to try to just get my presentation. So I don't know if any of you have seen the movie The Imitation Game. Can I see a show of hand? A few people. I was very intrigued by that movie. I thought it was interesting, and I thought it had quite a bit of applications in lupus, and I'll tell you why. Let me just make sure this goes with this here. Yes. So just in Canada, we have this conflicts of interest. So I'm on advisory board of a few companies that are starting to be interested in lupus. I think lupus is becoming quite trendy because a lot of new biologics agents are coming. We'll be discussing this afternoon. I have also been part of CANIOS, the Canadian Network for Improved Outcome in SLE, and I'm their past chair. So I thought I would introduce a little bit of Quebec City, because probably a few people here have been there, a map of Canada. I don't have a pointer, but if you see here, basically would be Toronto. And you'll see that Quebec City is further east, but still very south. And that in this whole region is the region that is referring to our center in Quebec City. So it's 1.8 million people, and the number of rheumatologists is about 15, probably, for that whole population. So there's still quite a bit of a short number of rheumatologists there. Recently, our five major academic hospitals have merged in one institution, so we've become the third biggest center in Canada with 18,000 employees. So it's going to give us power to build up on research, and hopefully a few years from now, I'll come back and tell you what we're doing in Quebec City. But let's move on to our topic from today. So you've seen this image that comes from the movie, The Imitation Game, and the word with that image that came was, behind every code is an enigma. And I think we'll all agree today that lupus is an enigma, and it's an enigma that needs to have a solution. So what do we have here? We have an enigma. The enigma machines had been created by the Germans to be able to transfer messages in a coded form, so that they could have a delivery, and if you had the key to the code, you could translate what this message that seemed to say nothing into a very important strategic message. So I would propose that in lupus, if we have a line with the arrow being the timeline, that what we have is the first thing is the code, and I think one of the code is the immune system losing this ability of protecting ourselves for our own antigens. So there's a loss of tolerance to nuclear antigens. I think one of the keys, if we could study our autoantibodies, we'd be maybe able to understand better what the code is. And obviously, what the message is what we see every day in our patients, the clinical disease. But I would like you to think of reverting a little bit at what we have also as experience. In research, what do we know? Well, we know that there's some preclinical phenomenon. We know that autoantibodies, for example, can be present, Oh, great. Yeah, thank you. And there's a pointer, probably. Okay, very good. So we know also that preclinical phenomenon can be detectable years before the disease onset. And then once you have the disease onset, you'll have a period of activity. And if you don't treat, or if you have unlucky, you can develop damage from your clinical lupus. But let's propose that we revert the timeline. As researchers, we'd like to go back to the source and try to find out what is the code and what's the result of that solution for the enigma. So if we look at that and we think of what do we have as tools, well, most of our current knowledge on lupus is really from established long-term disease in longitudinal observational studies. People that have, on average, maybe 10 years of evolution. And what we learn from that is really the whole accumulated events and a lot of damage. And what we want to try to do is go back closer to the onset or the preclinical phenomenon. There's very few rare studies and mostly unknown. So this is my little review of why I thought the imitation game might be a good title for this talk. And we could discuss it in the period question afterwards. So my three objectives today for this first lecture is to learn new development and research of biomarkers in lupus and some of the work we've been doing in Quebec City on microparticles, because I think you're going to hear a lot about it in the coming years. Then I've been asked, especially by Yasser, to discuss cardiovascular disease in lupus and understand the role of antiphospholipid antibodies and also thrombophilic risk factors. We often forget that lupus patients have a higher risk of thrombosis, either venous or arterial, even when they don't have antiphospholipid antibodies. So hopefully that will be a message to remember, especially when they're active, when their clinical activity is high. And then review principle of management in lupus pregnancies. So first, new development in the research on biomarkers. And you know, I think in lupus, sometimes our machine is still this very old type of computer that we have from the movie. But as compared to rheumatoid arthritis, where we have sorted out a lot of the complexity of how to best treat and manage our patients and understand a little more the disease in lupus, we're still at the early stage. So one of the tools that I've discovered lately is those microparticles. And these microparticles can be derived from platelets. And this is something that is new, that platelets are actually active mediator of inflammation. And they can be transferred through these microparticles. We'll see an image in a moment. They can be also mitochondrial microparticles coming from those platelets. And they can be extracellular mitochondrial microparticles. So here's an image of a platelet that's activated. And if you see these little burgeoning vesicles are really microparticles coming from that activated platelets. And they were unknown for many years because we just didn't have the tools to detect such a small element in the bloodstream or in the humans. These platelets, microparticles, can be stained and they can prove their origin. You see the plasma here. The membrane here, and they're annexing 5-positive with the gold beads that are marking them on electron microscopy. And they're very small, 100 nanometers. And what you do see, however, is that you can have other microparticles that would not stain for the same marker at the surface. So you have tools today with the flow cytometry to be able to characterize these very small microparticles. So why would they be of interest? This is, up until now, what you could detect. You could detect the size of a platelet through flow cytometry. But now we've been able to go up to 50 nanometers. And when you activate, this is a picture of an unstimulated platelet. But if you activate those platelets, you go from having no noise in the very small field of your flow cytometry into very active here with all of these microparticles that are being released once activated. So you can have these different microparticles that are, this is a resting platelet before activation. Platelets are, by the way, the biggest containers of mitochondria in the blood. Once they're activated, you can either see free mitochondria being released, you can see those microparticles, or you can have mitochondria that are englobed into that membrane from the platelets. Why is it of interest? Well, mitochondria have a long history of being allied with human or mammalian cells. Their origin is from bacteria. In fact, they thought to be very close to a rickettsia historically, millions of years ago. And they've adapted to be integrated into human cells or cells from plants, where they actually do an active role. What do, the mitochondria? Well, they consume and produce gases that are useful for our metabolism. they have a unique lipid composition, and that's one of the things I found fascinating, is that they're the only source of cardiolipin in the human body. Now, there's a relevance in lupus because we know that a third, usually, of our lupus cohorts will have anti-cardiolipin antibodies, and it was a bit of a mystery of how could you develop anti-cardiolipin specificity when human cells don't have cardiolipins on their surface, but they're really present in the membranes of the mitochondria. They can express formulated peptides. They also have, a DNA. And you know, we also know that there are reactions with double-stranded DNA antibody and all sorts of other nucleic acid antibodies. So there could be a source of antigen. And like I said earlier, they're from a bacterial origin. So you could think that the free mitochondria could be perceived or mistakenly perceived as an invader and as a bacteria and cause an immune reaction. So why is it relevant to lupus? Well, first, there's been work now showing that platelets can be seen in chronic inflammatory conditions, even in rheumatoid arthritis. Now there's good models showing that they can increase the reaction of the inflammation. And if we look at, this is early work from Quebec City, if you look at the presence of these mitochondria in the circulation or in the urine, here in urine, here in blood of patients with lupus, you see that there is an excess of these mitochondria being expressed. And there's a paper being under review, so I'm not showing those results, but we've been able to correlate disease activity with the level of these mitochondria and with the level of these microparticles. And we've also been able to show that these microparticles can be at the center of the immune complexes that are seen in lupus. So more to come about this, and I thought I would go into a little more of out of my field, which is the translational research, to introduce some topics for discussion later on. Now I'm going to go to the second objective, which is a little more clinical and maybe more for us today, which is the cardiovascular disease in lupus, and to understand the role of antiphospholipid antibodies and other thrombophilic risk factors in lupus. So if you look at the longitudinal observational studies over the last 50 years in lupus, you can see that there has been a marked increase in the five-year survival. In the 50s, we had reports that there were about 50% five-year survival in lupus patients. Now, in the most recent cohorts after 2000, you see that the survival is reported as high as 97%. However, I would question and caution that we have to be a little bit careful when interpreting these results, because although, yes, there has been definitively an improvement, there's some reasons to think that maybe this is not the whole picture. One of them is that first, in order to be part of these statistics, you have to have been into a cohort, a longitudinal observational cohort, and you had to survive the initial presentation, which we don't know exactly what mortality is around the peri-diagnostic area. So this is already a survivor effect. The other thing is we know that lupus has been a disease that is much better diagnosed today than before through all sorts of tools, so that the patients in the 1950s that were labeled as lupus were probably the only severe cases, the one with the highest disease activity, and now we have diagnosing better survival. So the survival story is a good story, the five-year survival, 97%. The 10 years and 5 years and 15-year survivals may not be so good. In Canada, we have the chance of having a unified healthcare system, and the statistics are universal. There's only one reimbursing system. So we can have access to those numbers. And Sasha Bernatsky, who's a rheumatologist at McGill University, got a hold to data from the Canadian healthcare system. And she's looked at what we call unadjusted standardized mortality rates. So the standardized mortality rates would be the number of observed deaths in a group of patients with lupus over the number of expected mortality for that same group of patients that would not have lupus, same age, same sex. And we see that if you look at all deaths, the SMR is 2.4, meaning that there was at least a doubling of the number of observed deaths over the number of expected deaths. So women with lupus were dying more than their counterparts of the same age in Canada. And then what she looked at, she did all sorts of trying to refine that analysis to understand who is at risk of having an excess in mortality. And in conclusion, those with renal disease, so it'll be very important today to talk about renal disease, infections, which often will happen usually around the time of diagnosis. So these are missed in the graphs I've showed you earlier with the longitudinal studies. Hematological malignancies, and in fact, Sasha Bernatsky has shown that the non-Hodgkin lymphoma is the main cause of hematological malignancies in lupus. And then cardiovascular disease, which is the topic of this objective today, which is a second peak usually arriving at 7 to 15 years after diagnosis. So there is this excess death. And if we look at mortality, long story short, who is at higher risk of dying early? Women, younger patients, and shorter disease duration. Now you have to realize this is a relative risk. So younger women, their risk of dying as a rule is very, very low. So any condition that will increase the risk of dying proportionally will show a big impact. So that's why we're seeing this disproportionate number of deaths in patients with lupus. And this is, though, a very significant matter. So I'm just trying to balance out the reassuring statistics that, yes, we see 97% survival at 5 years in 2005 in longitudinal cohorts, yet there is this unmet need or unseen need of early mortality in young women with lupus. Now, if we look at observational data from two large cohorts in Canada, we have access to a McGill cohort and we have access to a University of Toronto cohort. And if we look specifically at vascular events, so this is a survival graph. The blue line will show you thrombosis from the venous system and the red line from the arterial system. Well, there's a few messages here. First is that on the thrombosis for the venous system goes down and at one point plateaus, while there is almost a straight line going down with the arterial events. So there seems to be a risk of having arterial event that is constant over time, almost, and a risk of the venous event that is higher earlier on and plateaus. Now, so and this is the overall risk if you combine the two events. This cohort was a historical cohort, so patients entering the cohort at time zero could have a new diagnosis or could have had disease for 10 years. We could refine this a little more in the University of Toronto cohort because there was a large enough group of patients that we could call an inception cohort, so those who entered within a year of their diagnosis. And if we looked at that, we tried to see, is there the same pattern? So the same pattern is seen obviously a little later on because these all started at the onset of disease. There is a plateau of the venous events, but the arterial events still go down and maybe accelerates a little bit after 10 years of disease. So if we look at both of these cohorts and we see that is the probability at 5, 10, or 15 years of having a vascular event. So we can summarize these and you see that at 5 years, both cohorts show about a 95% survival, so 5% of people had an event. Then at 10 years, it goes closer to 10%. And then at 15 years, it basically goes to almost 18%. Of people. So it is a significant problem in our cohorts of patients with lupus. This is corroborated in the literature with other papers. One of them that I thought interesting in the New England Journal of Medicine, it's Roman who looked at ultrasound of the carotids and described a surrogate marker for atherosclerosis, which are carotid plaques, and saw that there was a disproportionate elevation even as young as people earlier than age 40, where 13.4% of their lupus patient compared to 2.4% of the controls had plaques, evidence of plaques in the carotids, and this is constant over time. There's a little bit of a catching up in the older age group, as you would expect, because the people that have no lupus start having their atherosclerosis, and that has led to this concept that there is premature atherosclerosis in lupus. Now, we've talked about two things in terms of cardiovascular events. There could be the venous events or there could be the arterial events. So let's review a little bit what are the relationship between maybe lupus, thrombophilia, and atherosclerosis. And we'll look at some, you know, the ideal in clinical research or in clinical epidemiology is to identify modifiable risk factors. And there are risk factors that you cannot change. Overall, men are at higher risk for cardiovascular disease than women. This is usually not changeable. A modifiable risk factor is antiphospholipid antibodies and maybe this concept of a double hit. There's other antibodies, heat shock protein, but also is there an importance in trying to characterize those, and is one antibody alone significant on its own, or is it worse if you have two or three of these risk factors? And then what kind of intervention to prevent or decrease arterial disease could be considered? So this is a graph trying to summarize maybe in terms of different endothelial dysfunction and damage in arterial disease. In lupus, you have the traditional risk factors. So our patients do accumulate those, maybe earlier than the general population, like hypertension if they have renal disease. There could be dyslipidemia. Sometimes some of our drugs will affect that. And there could be also diabetes, so the traditional risk factors. Then there's inflammatory factors that may be generic to any of our rheumatic diseases. We know also that rheumatoid arthritis patients have an increased risk of early cardiovascular disease. So what is it that's generic about inflammation? But independent of those two traditional and inflammatory risk factors, has lupus per se have specific risk factors for vascular disease? And obviously the one that comes to mind would be antiphospholipid antibodies, for example. Now this can lead to endothelial dysfunction. Whoops, I was a bit quick. Then development of atherosclerosis, rupture plaque, acute ischemic event, or it could go to a problem that is a loss of antithrombotic properties and then hypercoagulability. So you could have either a purely atherosclerotic pattern with slowly stenosing arteries, or you could have an acute event imposed on it with a thrombosis. So we're interested in the lupus risk factors. So what are different risk factors we could consider? Well, there's nutritional. Are lupus patients affected differently by their nutrition? And is it important to actually look at maybe things like fatty acids and omega-3 and omega-6 ratio, for example? Autoantibodies, I've mentioned those before, but you could also think of antibodies that right now we're not characterizing, like endothelial cell antibodies, maybe will become important in the future. And you could think of inflammation, just disease activity. So certainly disease activity now has been demonstrated as being a risk for thrombosis in venous events. So could it be also a pattern in arterial events? And then endothelial dysfunction and damage. Is the endothelium a target that maybe we've been neglecting to autoimmunity in lupus? So antiphospholipid antibody, we cannot not talk about them. They're central. They're very prevalent in our patients with lupus. I would say at least a third of our patients normally in all of the large cohorts I've looked at had at least detectable antiphospholipid antibody. Now, this is a whole field of controversy in terms of definitions and what constitutes a clinically relevant antibody. Normally, the antiphospholipid group has defined that you would have to have a persistency of the antibody testing, and you would have to have it present at significant levels. We'll review that in a moment. But the big three that are used still clinically are the anticardiolipin, the lupus anticoagulant, and the anti-beta-2-glycoprotein-1 antibodies. Now, there are other antiphospholipid antibodies that we haven't even started using routinely in clinic. But there's prothrombin, annexing A2, oxidized LDL, and there are phosphatidylserine, phosphatidylethanol. I mean, there's a whole list of them that are being studied in the research, but that are not useful at this point or proven to be useful in clinic. Historically, also, there were some other antibodies like the false positive VDRL, which we don't use really very much anymore, and these other targets. So, anticardiolipin antibody, the one that we measure clinically, could be either an IgG, an IgM, or an IgA, depending on the lab you're using. Most of the ones that have been studied for clinical relevance are the IgG and the IgM isotypes. And they're defined as high titers, which are, there's an international standardization of these, so they're measured in phospholipid units, and they should be at least 40 or higher phospholipid units. So you could have a GPL, so an IgG phospholipid units of 40, or an MPL, an IgM phospholipid unit of 40 or higher. They have definitively been detected in, depending on the series, 20 to 60% of lupus patients. In my experience, closer to maybe 30%. 10 to 30% of women with recurrent spontaneous abortion have had those. We see that in maybe primary antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. And then 19% of persons with primary arterial or venous thrombosis, when you look at these cohort, not lupus patients, but just patients that present with these events, they've been detected as having anticardiolipin antibodies. So over time, this is an ELISA that was defined in 1986, and the ability to screen has been much more useful since the 1990s. And we're still, though, defining the spectrum of these antibodies and their role clinically. The lupus anticoagulant may be much more specific and useful when it's positive because of its the way the assay is done is a functional assay, and anticardiolipin antibodies, you're just measuring a titer. But to be able to demonstrate that you have a lupus anticoagulant, you have to see that in a laboratory you have a functional effect of the antibody because it interferes with a coagulation assay in the lab. So it could be an IgM or an IgG, rarely an IgA, and it has this capacity of prolonging the phospholipid-dependent coagulation assay. So it's really a misnomer when you think about it. It's called a lupus anticoagulant because it does prolong your assay in the lab, but it is mostly associated with an increased risk of thrombosis. So that's why I say it's a misnomer. It binds to phospholipid portion of the prothrombinase complex, and in doing so, inhibits its ability in the lab to clot, and it requires a protein cofactor, so either beta-2-glycoprotein 1 or prothrombin as a rule to be working. And there is now an international procedure that has been defined. The international procedures will make sure that first you have to detect a prolongation of a phospholipid-dependent coagulation assay in the lab. The second step will be that if you mix 50-50 plasma from the patient and plasma from a pooled group of people that have normal coagulation factors, if you mix them, there's still a prolongation. So it's not just a factor deficiency. You eliminate the fact that it could be a coagulation factor deficiency in your second step. And the third step is that you will then mix your patient's plasma with some phospholipid to inhibit the antibody before you carry on your assay, and therefore there should be a correction of the abnormality in the lab. And those three steps are essential to say that yes, you have a lupus anticoagulant that's related to a phospholipid effect. The third antibody that's used clinically is the anti-beta-2-glycoprotein 1 antibody. Again, this is a protein, it's a serum protein that binds to phospholipid. And the binding of the serum protein to the phospholipid seems to change the three-dimensional configuration of the complex and therefore makes it antigenic. So if they're both side by side and not interacting, they're not antigenic, but the binding of the two changes the configuration. The beta-2-glycoprotein complex is five repeating motifs. It's been described, if you looked at it, as sushi domains. And it's the fifth domain that seems to specifically bind to phospholipid, and that may become important. They're trying to refine the specificity of the assays. They're trying to target whether they could measure specifically on the fifth domain. And may be essential to the pathogenic anticardiolipin antibody. This is of interest because we know that you can have transient positive anticardiolipin antibodies sometimes after a viral infection or some type of drug use. The one that would be pathogenic and associated with an increased risk of thrombosis would require that you find also the presence of the glycoprotein 1 on the complex. And then, are they pathogenic on their own without the phospholipid component? This is still debatable, but the evidence seems to show that, yes, they're important, independent of positive anticardiolipin or positive lupus anticoagulant, they have been associated with increased risk of thrombosis. And one of the things that has not been done yet is a standardization of the assay. We've said that the cardiolipin has been standardized with MPL and GPL units. Here, you have to go by each of the kits and try to define your risk at maybe 95% or 99% percentile above the normal. So we've defined three clinically useful antibodies, antiphospholipid antibodies, that are associated prospectively with risk of thrombosis. Now you could say, well, we have three of them, which one is best, or which one should I use? And there's still possibilities of playing with that a little bit. So you could say either the presence of N antiphospholipid antibody, whichever one of the three might be important. But you could also say, qualitatively, is there a difference between a lupus anticoagulant or an anticardiolipin antibody? You could also go with the levels. So the two antibodies that are measured by ELISAs, which is the anticardiolipin and the anti-beta 2 glycoprotein 1, are measurable. And you could say maybe a higher level increase the risk of thrombosis. And yet you could also go by, you know, whether I have one, two, or three of these antibodies, like what I would call a full house, is that a higher risk than just having one of them? The other way is persistence of antiphospholipid antibodies over time. Does it carry a risk? And finally, you could think of having the antiphospholipid antibody plus other thrombophilic risks, like a genetic, maybe factor 5 of Leiden mutation or another risk for thrombophilia. You can see that gets to be very complex, and dissecting out what is the true risk carried by the antiphospholipid antibodies per se is a bit difficult. But let's look at some of those definitions. First, the presence of an antiphospholipid antibody prospectively. So we've done a large cohort in Montreal that we followed patients over 10 years, and we characterized them at baseline as to their risk for thrombosis or arterial events. And we looked at whether they had an antiphospholipid antibody or not. So in the groups that had no antiphospholipid antibody, we see here the curve over a number of weeks here about the risk of having an arterial event. Now, those who had antiphospholipid antibody clustered much below. And that was one of the first studies that actually looked prospectively at whether having an antiphospholipid antibody, when you adjust with all of the other risk factors for having an arterial event, does it still carry a risk prospectively? Because until then, a lot of the studies had been done retrospectively, and there's always a risk of a selection bias. So this is a given now. Antiphospholipid antibody does carry a risk independent of other risk factors. Now, you could look at the type of antiphospholipid antibody. And here we're looking at whether you have no antiphospholipid antibody, so the curves you've just saw, versus having one or the other, or three antiphospholipid antibodies. So if you have only one, if you have no antiphospholipid antibody, this is the green curve. And if you had the three of them, you can see that your proportion of having an antiphospholipid antibody is 50% at 100 weeks, so almost two years to 2.5 years. So huge difference between the two with confidence interval that separates very quickly. And in between, you could look at every which combination, and as you expect, they will be in between those two lines. So I'll quickly flash them here. So whether you have lupus anticoagulant alone, whether you have combination of anticardiolipin and lupus anticoagulant, or if you have anticardiolipin alone. Okay. So the point here is having a full house is worse than obviously having none or one of those antiphospholipid antibodies. So if we look at that again, the number of antiphospholipid antibodies, we just didn't look at the quality, which one they were, but if you had three antiphospholipid antibodies, you obviously are not doing very well compared to zero. And in between, you have one, two, and three. And persistent positivity, in our hands, we couldn't show much of a difference between the two groups, although there seemed to be a trend. But this is one of the requirements of the definition for antiphospholipid antibodies, just to rule out the possibility of having a transient positive following an infection or an exposure to medication. So it's still an important concept. So in summary, from what I've just said on antiphospholipid antibodies, a positive APL test predicts an overall higher risk of thrombosis when compared to those who are APL negative. And from these curves, what we deducted is that the risk was 10% higher, which was clinically and statistically important. That this risk can be further refined by characterizing the antiphospholipid antibody. So there was a difference. It is as different as 44% and 36% higher in those with three antiphospholipid antibodies when compared to those with no or one or two APL positive tests. So there was a demarcation. The presence of one or more antiphospholipid antibody increases the four-year risk of thrombosis overall by 10%. The persistent positivity and higher number of APL increases the risk of thrombosis at 4 years and they're probably important markers of specificity in this syndrome. So, what about treatment of thrombophilia in lupus? Well, there is, in the absence of antiphospholipid antibodies, so just recently, this week, I saw a young man with lupus for 6 years that had been totally in remission, who came up with a flare, with hemolytic anemia, and with polyarthritis. And complained of having, last week, the week before he saw me, a painful calf, and he had still minimal pitting edema, and all in for all, you know, he had a Doppler that was positive for DVT. Now, this gentleman does not have antiphospholipid antibody and has never had antiphospholipid antibody over the last 6 years, and I think it illustrates that just inflammation and active lupus is also a thrombophilic risk factor per se. But if they persistently do not have antiphospholipid antibody, I guess the decision is left to consider, do you want to stop anticoagulation? I think you could, but only if your disease activity would be totally in remission for a significant period of time, so at least 6 to 12 months, I would say. So you would probably treat them slightly differently than just a normal DVT in someone who has no other risk factors or no inflammatory disease, in that you would prolong your anticoagulation until you're satisfied that the inflammation component of their disease is controlled. But in the presence of antiphospholipid antibodies, I think long-term anticoagulation, if no other risk factor is present, is still considered standard, and to evaluate the risk if other risk factors are present and decide. So for example, someone who comes in who was maybe on hormones with estrogens, is that the one that triggered the event, and they also had an antiphospholipid antibody? Some groups will say, well, we could give them one chance, but I think that's a little scary myself, and we need more studies. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, if someone has already
had a thrombosis? So someone, well, whether the persistent positive is before or after the thrombosis, if they've had two antiphospholipid antibodies at least 3 months apart that are positive, they fit that definition.
In the face of a thrombotic event.
Right, if they've had that, yeah.
What if they don't have the event?
Oh, that's a whole, yeah. I wouldn't treat prophylactically at this point. Oh, that's different. I don't think there's evidence that we have. It's left to our judgment. And what I do basically is I discuss it with the patient, and I tell them the risk of having a complication of aspirin is very low. It's there. It's very low, and the risk of having an event might be higher than that. And I would say most of my patients decide to take the aspirin, but I still would discuss it because we don't have firm guidelines about that. But it's a very good point. Now, the other thing is, it's still useful to know if you had persistent positive APLs and no events, because if you take a long trip, you advise them to use prophylaxis, right? And, you know, things like that are important against estrogen, again, you don't want to take, or anything that would increase your risk that you can modify, right? So, how are we doing? Yeah, good. Review basic principles in management of lupus pregnancy that was asked. So, lupus pregnancies, in my mind, should be considered high risk. Even in mild lupus cases, if they've had definite lupus, and I think they should be planned and monitored very closely, and the ideal setup would be in a team. I'm a very much of a team work person. I've been working with Joanne on a combined lupus nephritis clinic when I was in Toronto. I've replicated that now with my colleague David Philibert in Quebec City. When we have a pregnancy in lupus, I immediately refer them to the high-risk pregnancy group, because I think they have an approach to offer that complements the one we have. So, if we look at maybe dividing this in four, planning the pregnancy, the unusual risks that you have to be aware of in a lupus pregnancy, monitoring during the lupus pregnancy, and postpartum visit, which we often forget. This is still very important because there might be an increased risk of flare in the few weeks following the delivery. So planning the pregnancy, first, I think it's pretty much agreed that there should be disease quiescence for at least 6 months before a pregnancy is contemplated. And that could be on stable doses of medication, but we'll see, medications are a big issue here in our lupus patients. So you want to maximize the control of disease activity and risk factors such as blood pressure, for example. And then you have to look at the overall disease severity and the higher risk. Whoops, do you see that? Yeah. And the higher risk of complication. So it's well known that if you have lupus nephritis, this is a notch higher in terms of risk for complication during the pregnancy. Thrombophilia would be another one. And then if you had previous complications of pregnancy, if you've already had a preeclampsia or some fetal outcome that was unfavorable, that would be also something to consider in your next pregnancy. So before conceiving, what are the things to check? Well, you want to check for maybe autoantibodies that could adversely affect your pregnancy. So we all know about the anti-Rho SSA and anti-La SSB that could be associated with neonatal lupus, congenital heart block, or cardiac fibrosis in the newborn, right? Or persistent or pregnancy-induced antiphospholipid antibodies, which could be accompanied with either recurrent spontaneous abortions or a fetal growth retardation, or even sometimes fetal death due to a placental vascular insufficiency. So just to consider to do before would be testing for those antiphospholipid antibodies we've just discussed, looking for the anti-Rho SSA and anti-La SSB antibodies. And then you want to look at their renal function, make sure that creatinine and that their sediment, their urine analysis with sediment are inactive at the time. And you know, a few other things, want to make sure they don't have cytopenias, don't have anything active, so you do a CBC, liver function test, and look at their anti-DSDNA complement for lupus disease activity. Then the medication counseling. This is really central to a visit planning pregnancy, a pre-pregnancy visit. And you want to review the medication list. Our patients are often on 8 or 10 medications. So not only do we have to review the lupus medication, but we have to also review the concomitant medication being given sometimes for symptoms. So first, we have to look at stop or replacing the immunomodulators that the patient might be taking. There's two options to that. If someone's really being in remission and there's a lot of time ahead of them, they may consider tapering off their immunosuppressors and just keeping them on antimalarials for maintenance of remission. We'll talk about treatments in the second talk, but this could be one thing that could be considered. The way, though, I discuss this with my patients would be that, yes, we can do that, but if you have a flare, we're going to be off for your pregnancy for another year or two because we'll need to reinduce remission and wait at least 6 months, you know, after the induction of remission. But the medication that would be a no-no during pregnancy are methotrexate, leflunomide, all of the mycophenolates, cyclophosphamide, with an exception that if you really had someone presenting with lupus during pregnancy and they're in the later phase of their pregnancy, exceptionally we use them. Now, steroids would be okay at the lowest dose possible, and the other drugs that we allow during pregnancies are antimalarials, azathioprine, and cyclosporin. Now, what about biologic agents like belimumab? Well, there's no data in the recommendations right now is not to use them, preferably. And the other consideration at the preconception visit is now more and more because of their lupus having been added to the group of patients with high risk of preeclampsia and eclampsia is to give them aspirin early on during the pregnancy. So the other thing is think of all of the other medications they're on, right? Because if they've had lupus nephritis, they might be on an ACE or an ARB, and they may need to be switched to control either their blood pressure to another medication that's acceptable during pregnancy, or to stop if it's only for protein, to try to decrease the proteinuria. And then review all other medications. For example, if they're on a PPI or on Coumadin, there are decisions that will have to be made. So the other thing is if a change is needed, then you need to at least wait 6 months to make sure that they don't flare because of the change you've made in their immunosuppressor. So someone who would be on CellCept, on mycophenolate, mofetil, if you change them to Imuran, well, it's not sure that they're not going to flare. So I tell them we're going to wait 6 months before we okay the pregnancy. The unusual risk to look at, so increased maternal mortality. Again, this is a relative risk, but we say that women with lupus, their relative risk could be as high as 20 compared to a healthy mother population, just because the risk of dying during pregnancy is so low to start with. But what are the complications that could happen? Well, increased risk of thrombosis in women with lupus who have pregnancies compared to their counterpart, increased risk of infection, thrombocytopenia, and need of transfusion, And the obstetrical complication could be preterm labor, which is quite frequent, unplanned C-section, fetal growth retardation, or preeclampsia and eclampsia. In the fetal complications, the fetal loss, we talked about growth restriction, the neonatal lupus syndromes, and complication of prematurity. So you've gone through the whole review for your preconception, things are looking good, and the patient is now pregnant. So what should we do as rheumatologists? Well, I think at each of the trimester, we should at least have one visit plan to make sure that their disease is not acting up during pregnancy, in which case you would want to treat as quickly as possible. So to assess lupus disease activity. And then I think they should be followed at the high-risk pregnancy, as I mentioned earlier, and they should have their blood pressure and proteinuria checks. They may have more ultrasound than the normal population. Certainly, there should be one at the first trimester to make sure that the growth of the fetus is at the date they're planned, that they were planned, and that the third trimester to make sure that there are not any retardation in terms of growth. But there could be needs of ultrasound in between. Laboratory test again, complete blood count, checking the urine and making sure their kidneys are stable, and the disease activity through dsDNA and C3 and C4. Then finally, the postpartum visit, which we don't want to miss. So make sure that they come back about a month after delivery and that they haven't activated their lupus in terms of disease activity clinically or in terms of their labs. So, in this first part of today, I wanted to review and learn maybe about new biomarkers, specifically the microparticles and the specificity maybe of mitochondria in lupus. We've reviewed thrombosis and cardiovascular disease in lupus and the role of antiphospholipid antibody and some basic principles in the management of lupus pregnancy. And so, crack the code and win the war is our motto in lupus. Thank you very much.
I think we can take one or two questions before we move to the next speaker. Any questions from the audience?
Yes. Get a patient stable on lupus patient stable, and she got pregnant. She's on Plaquenil every other day. Do you add small dose prednisolone or continue it with Plaquenil every other day, or you increase Plaquenil to once a day?
And this patient is stable, and there's no sign of increased activity.
Correct. Yeah.
I would keep them at what they are. I would use the steroids if there is a change in disease activity, because that would.
So you don't add small dose steroid beginning of pregnancy till the end of pregnancy.
I wouldn't, because you know there's still an increased risk of some complications due to the steroids in terms of infections. So I would stay away from the steroids if she remains stable. Yeah.
Any other questions?
We're all talking about the detectable antiphospholipid antibodies, and we all know that there might be antibodies that we don't know about. So I'm wondering how we can manage those patients with the syndrome without having the detectable antibodies.
So this APS negative syndrome, right? The APS without antiphospholipid antibodies. So those either that presents with recurrent fetal loss or...
Right, especially when it comes when you said that we can stop, we can consider stopping the treatment of anticoagulation if the patient has negative antibodies.
Yeah.
But how do we know that the patient does not have antibodies?
Well there's two aspects to my answer to your question. One of them is, right now, we do not know whether these other antiphospholipid antibodies are clinically important. Right, and until we prove that they're clinically important and associated with an increased risk of thrombosis, I don't think we can necessarily make any decision based on that. So I would say that if the three antiphospholipid antibodies that we've discussed that are clinically relevant are negative, I would consider that patient as negative for antiphospholipid antibodies, because otherwise we're opening up quite a bit of a can of worms. The second part of my answer, though, is that after having discussing the risk and benefit with the patients, if they do have a recurrence, which we hope they don't, well, then they're committed for long-term anticoagulation anyway, right? Whether they have antiphospholipid antibodies or not. But it's that intermediate period, right, where you're going to have to live with the anxiety of possibly having a second event, right? That's quite difficult.